Facebook. So welcome to everybody who's joining us there, and welcome to all of us who are here, and we will definitely be praying for everybody as we deal with a little bit of real winter. A reminder that later on in this service we're going to have communion. And Pastor Rick is here to officiate communion. So if you're watching this online, you may want to prepare some bread and some wine equivalent for later on. And we are going to be listening to another sermon from Village Church. I posted the link to the sermon on Facebook. Also, it will be, if you're watching this on YouTube, it will be in an email with the YouTube link so that you can skip watching it on the screen here and watch it directly, but it will also always, the full thing will be here. Let's open in prayer. We will spend some time worshiping. Dear God, our Father in heaven, we thank you for this country. And sometimes it's hard to be thankful when it's 40 below. But you brought us here and you've given us the prosperity to have warm houses, to have vehicles, to have ways to make a living. So that we have, we can live here, and you look after us. But we still are reminded that we can't do everything on our own, and we need your help. So we thank you that you are our good shepherd, and we thank you for your care and your protection, and we pray for your continual care and protection. And we think of the people who've been in and out of hospital this week, and we know that our bodies are as they are here, are not our eternal bodies. They are corruptible, that we will be raised incorruptible, and we look forward to that day. But in the meantime, we ask that you would be the great physician and heal us and protect us and cover us. This morning, as we turn our eyes and our hearts to you, pray that we would be open to receiving what you have for us this morning. And as we remember your sacrifice on the cross through communion, help us to be worthy of remembering, and help us to be reconciled to our brothers and sisters. I pray that you would be in charge of every part of this service, and that you would help it to flow smoothly to your glory, and that we would hear what we need to hear today. In Jesus' name, amen. I have a magic button. Let's see if I can get it to work. There, it's on now. There. Now the screen matches what's going on. We'll see how long that works. If you have your hymn book with you, this hymn is number 414, and it's six verses long, and I'm going to sing all six verses. But fortunately, it's only two lines per verse. This is a wonderful prayer, and when I was singing through it with Glenda this morning, I thought, you know, I could sing this every morning and make this my morning prayer. If you're watching from home, look up the lyrics to "May the Mind of Christ My Savior," and follow along if you can. May the mind of Christ my Savior live in me from day to day. By his love and power controlling all I do and say. May the word of God dwell richly in my heart from hour to hour, so that all may see I triumph only through his power. May the peace of God my Father rule my life in everything, that I may be called to comfort sick and sorrowing. May the love of Jesus fill me as the waters fill the sea, Him exalting, self-abasing, this is victory. May I run the race before me, strong and brave to face the foe, looking only unto Jesus as I onward go. May his beauty rest upon me as I seek the lost to win, and may they forget the channel seeing only here. Amen. Yeah. Come on. this next one is a, the song is called You Are, I Am. It's a declaration of who God is in contrast to who I am. So it starts with my perception of myself, and it also talks about who God is and what he's done to rescue me. So this is my testimony. I think it's your testimony too.
Amen.
Amen. That's my Jesus. That's who we're praying to, the one who met Daniel in the lion's den and his three friends in the fire. The one who took a shepherd boy and said, "You're going to be king," and then he helped him kill a giant. What are we worried about? Let's talk to Jesus. Jesus, my Savior, God, my Father, Spirit, my Counselor, thank you that you are here and that you've rescued me. Thank you that you've rescued us. Thank you that the curse of sin has no hold on me, that I've been set free. Thank you, Spirit, that you are giving me new life, even in the midst of this world that's crumbling and falling apart because this world has rejected you, just as it always has. Thank you for giving us a mission to be your church here in Onaway. To be a light that shines on the hill. As I was driving in, I could see the smoke from the power stations from miles and miles away. Lord, may our church produce glory that can be seen from miles and miles away. Not that we would get the glory, but that it would point to you. That people would forget the channel and see only you. Lord, may this service be an offering of praise and thanksgiving to you. We have so much to be thankful for. Lord, Mrs. Schultz is home from the hospital. We thank you that you have healed her to this point. We know that she has a lot of medications and there's some uncertainty about her care, Lord. We also know that your hands and feet are involved in reaching out to her, in helping her, and in caring for her. We thank you that we, as a church body, can be your hands and feet. Lord, we know that Kathy Winkleman is facing some fear and uncertainty, and we don't know what the diagnosis is exactly. We don't know what your plan is for her body. You have given her a lot of health in the last few years. You've brought her up and given her hope and given her a vision of how she could be a faithful servant in the kingdom. You've rescued her, and I pray that you continue to rescue her and hold her heart and do not let her fall prey to the fiery darts of the evil one that are attacking her. Let her shield be up and strong. Lord, this week, our family of the week is the Sammy, Stephen and Shelley, Michaela Taylor and Brookie. Lord, you have called them to be a light. You've called them to be a faithful witness. You've called them to produce much fruit. I pray that their home would be a home of joy. I pray that there would be love and strength as they love each other. I pray that there would be no dissension or division in that family, that the girls would be a light in their with their friends, wherever they are sent, that both Stephen and Shelley would know why they're doing what they're doing, and that every day they would be bold in sharing your love, and when they see the opportunity to share the good news, that they would be able to speak it with boldness and with love and with gentleness. I pray that you would continue to keep them healthy and safe, but I pray that even more that you would protect their hearts and minds so that no matter what happens, they would be seen to be a family that trusts in Jesus. Lord, I pray for Brentview Baptist Church, and there's another interim pastor there, Phil Odd, and we know how that is, and we're in even maybe more of a desperate situation, but we're not desperate because you are our shepherd. And this is your church, and we are trying to follow your lead. So we pray for Brentview Baptist that they also would submit themselves to you and follow the steps that you have for them one step at a time with faith and with courage and without fear. And I pray that you would make them a shining light on a hill in Calgary, that the Brentview neighborhood and all around would see that you make a difference in people's lives. Thank you for sending people all over the world to unreached people groups. We pray that you would bless them today in a special way. I thank you for the missionaries that each of us are in contact with, and Lord, may you bring us into contact with more of your servants so that we would pray and so that we would give, so that we would be faithful in supporting your body all around the world, and so that we would expand our vision beyond our little corner of the world to see what you're doing and the victories that you are winning all over in Asia, in the Philippines, in China, in Africa, in South America, even in Europe. Lord, you don't want any to perish. So we pray that we would be ascending church. Pray for our youth. There are no youth here today, and it's a tragedy that that's true, but we are sending out this message to people on screens all around, and we pray for the kids who are hearing this, and we pray for the kids who are watching the Ellerslie Baptist Kids Ministry, or the SABC Kids Ministry, or the ones who are watching videos from right now. Thank you for the resources that we have to put the Bible into a medium that the kids understand. But Lord, may we love our kids and our teenagers, and may we find ways to disciple them and bring them up in the way they should go. I pray for Dr. Terry Fawcett and his ministry in Alberta, and all the churches that are going through crisis in this crisis. And this year doesn't look like it's going to be an end to the crisis. It's just the extension as we're waiting for the numbers to go down, for the vaccines to come, for the tide to turn and the rules to change. Lord, I pray that there would be wisdom, that you would give Terry wisdom, and that he would give it to us, the church leaders, in all the churches that he is caring for, and that we would again glorify you in what we do. I pray for our governments at every level, from the town, the county, the province, the country. At every level there is challenges. At every level there's people who are being torn between selfish ambition and the good of their people. And there's people presenting things that appear to be wise but might not be wise. Lord, you are the wise counselor. I pray that you would bring wise counsel to our leaders, that they would hear it and follow it, and so that we would be protected and blessed. I know that in the stories of the kings of Israel, there's many times where you intentionally confused the hearts of kings because you had a plan to teach those people a lesson. Lord, we don't want to have to go through that. Lord, may we learn the lesson the easy way, not the hard way. Lord, I pray for our schools as we deal with uncertainty, and I pray for our teachers, I pray for the principals, I pray for the moms and dads that are trying to teach these kids, and I pray that this experience would not lead to gaps in the kids' development, but that they would be drawn, be able to grow up and find blessing. But Lord, we know that Canada is a wonderful place, but without you there is no true peace. So I pray for a way to bring the gospel to all these children who are going to grow up and be lost. Thank you for what you've done with Mrs. Chultzen. I pray for all of the people who are now stuck in their homes, and especially as it's cold, Lord, pray for the people who lost power last night, that they would be recovered, that furnaces would start again, that houses would warm up, and I pray for the man that you're calling to be our next pastor, and for the search committee that is going to be called, and for the whole process of bringing us and him and his family together. I pray that you would be the matchmaker, and that we would just follow your direction, and that would be smooth. All these things, Lord, we can't do any of those things on our own. We don't have enough wisdom, we don't have enough strength, but you are the God of wisdom and the God of unimaginable strength. You can do whatever you decide to do, so we ask that you would bless us, not because we deserve it, but because you chose to love us for some reason. Thank you. In Jesus' name, amen. All right, so we're switching. The Village Church is a big church. It's got lots of campuses, and it's got a very young and energetic senior pastor named Mark Clark, and my kids love him. I'm not sure we're ready for Mark Clark. He's a lot. And I was going to do Psalm 23, and he spent 45 minutes on verses 1 and the first part of verse 2 of Psalm 23. And I listened to parts of it, and it was like drinking from a fire hose. So I went looking for somebody else, and he has a lot of guest speakers in this series on the Psalms. I think eventually, when we're not doing communion, when it's not a full Sunday, I might do this Psalm 23 series, but I'll warn you ahead of time that it's quite a bit to deal with. But this is Kurt Harlow. He's, as you'll find out, he's from California. He's a guest speaker at that church, and so he gets to be a guest speaker at our church. So those of you watching at home, there's a link. Hopefully you can follow the link and watch this directly, or you can continue to watch here.
Here from Bayside Church down in Northern California. I'm so glad to be at Village Church teaching on Psalms today. You might remember me, I came one other time and taught on prayer, and Mark's asked me back, and I'm really excited about this series, and I'm excited about this psalm that we're going to study today, Psalm 34. If you got a Bible, you can turn there. This psalm is amazing because it does something for us, the reader, the learner, that a lot of passages in the Bible don't do. It gives us context. See, it's very, very important whenever you study the Bible to understand the context. Who wrote it? Why did they read it? What was the occasion that they wrote it? And this is actually the context of David at the beginning of his fugitive period. These are David's fugitive declarations. This is David actually writing this incredible song when he's on the run. Well, explain this to me, Kurt. Here's the context. We know it exactly from the psalm itself. It says, of David, when he pretended to be insane before Abimelech, who drove him away, and he left. Okay, so what in the world is going on here? There's this song, this hit song, and the song goes something like, hey, Saul used to be a really good warrior, but now David is way better than him, and this thing is a hit. It's going all over Israel. Everyone's singing about David and how Saul is kind of the has-been, and David is the new cool guy. He's the new kids on the block for surely. And this thing, man, it's got a dance craze to it. It's got merchandise. It's gone TikTok famous. I mean, this song is blowing up, and it drives Saul absolutely nuts. Who's Saul? He's the king, the current king of Israel, and he gets so crazy nuts, he goes to try to kill David and his buddies. So David and his buddies, they take off. They're like, we're going to have none of this. And they go up to this priest friend of his, and when they find the priest is like, hey, the song's here too. You got to leave. So they grab Goliath. Remember him? They grab his sword, and because the song has gotten all the way to the priest, they run to the Philistines. Okay, they go out of Israel into Philistine territory, and they think, Saul's not going to pursue us here. No one knows about this hit song of Saul's the has-been, David's the great guy. So we're going to the Philistines. Well, they get there. Guess what? First guy that sees him. You know that David and Saul song? That's the David in the David and Saul song. You know the big summer hit? That guy, that's the platinum record. That's the David in this song. And so the Philistines are starting to go, oh my gosh, this is the guy. And David's like, this is going to get us in trouble. I'm going to get killed. My guys are going to get killed. So he acts crazy. I know, you can't make this stuff up. And he gets kicked out of the Philistine king's palace. And he goes, hides in a cave. It gets better. He gets to the cave, and everyone who's got a bad credit score but really good at fighting has shown up at the cave. David is gone. He's gone K-pop. I mean, he's so popular right now. He can't hide anywhere, not in the enemy's camp, not in the cave. And this whole group show up. They're like, David, we'll fight for you. By the way, we love the song, and we're on your side. And so what does David do? He's trying to hide. He's trying to be a fugitive. He's trying to get away. What does he do? He does the one thing that I would never do. He writes another song. David says, listen, I'm tired of this David versus Saul song. My life isn't about David versus Saul. This David versus Saul thing has gotten me into tons of trouble. I'm sick and tired of that dance craze. I'm sick and tired of that TikTok. I'm going to write the real song that should be the real hit. And he writes it. And this thing blows up in Psalm 34. This thing becomes the greatest hit in the history of hits. It's so big. I mean, it's bigger than Savage Love. It's bigger than Breaking Me. It's bigger than Roses. It's bigger than Mamacita. Oh, wait. I'm talking to Christians. You guys don't know any of those songs, do you? It's bigger than You're a Good, Good Father. It's bigger than Oceans. It's bigger than The Blessing. It's bigger than Graves into Gardens. I mean, it's huge. So big is this hit, so big is this song, that literally thousands of generations of people have studied its meaning. In a cave, as a fugitive, on the run, in great trial and chaos, David says some things about God, where he can be found, and how you and I should respond to him to change the game. What is the hit? What did he say? Well, let's go ahead and just get right into it. I'm going to read verse by verse all the way through the whole psalm. I'm going to stop two or three times, let you know a couple of things about the context and kind of what David is doing in the middle of this psalm, and then we're going to draw out three giant principles. Don't leave. Don't you dare leave. Now, they're telling me on the interweb, experts are telling me that some of you watch only part of the sermon. Don't do that. All the way through all the verses to the big application of the end. Here we go. Part one. If you're taking notes, I hope you are. Write this down. Worshiping God. He starts with worshiping God. Part one. Verse one. I will extol the Lord at all times. His praise will always be on my lips. Extol means to bow down. He's starting with humility. I will kneel before God, he says. I'll make my heart right before my Creator. Number two, I will glory. This is to brag, to hype, to celebrate in the Lord. Let the afflicted hear and let them rejoice. Glorify the Lord with me. Now, I will glory in the Lord, and glorify the Lord with me are two different words there. Very similar, related, but they're different words. And what glory means is I'll make him high. I will actually be loud about this. This is not a shy praise. This is not an internal praise. This is not a gentle little hands going up before the Lord. This is David saying, no one's going to stop me from expressing how I feel about my God and what he's done. Glory the Lord with me. Let us exalt, lift up his name together. Why? Why extol, why glory, why glorify, why exalt? Verse 4 tells us, I sought the Lord and he answered me. He delivered me from all my fears. David's saying that it's amazing how much access he has to the God of the universe. David is saying that he cannot believe how committed God is to him. David is saying, me, lowly David, I'm not impressed with a hit song about me. I'm not impressed with people are saying about my warrior reputation. I'm impressed that God would have anything to do with me, let alone answer my prayers and soothe my fears. You know, you become a worshiper, you get to understand who God is. It's not just reciting songs or saying things. It's about understanding who is. And when you understand who God is, you won't help but become a worshiper. You know, people always say, my religion is a private thing between you and me. That's not how David felt. David said, I'm going to praise him. I'm going to lift him up. I'm going to hype him up. I'm going to tell you who he is. And I'm going to invite you to join me. Dave, you ever seen a kid in the store that just sings and they don't care who's listening? We're in the store and I am having a good day with my mom. And they're just singing. And something along the way, they get a little adolescent-y and they get some self-consciousness and they stop actually having that joy. David keeps the joy. And he's unashamed about it. He's childlike, he's audacious, he's passionate. And then he switches. He goes from Buddy the Elf, just singing out loud for anyone to hear, to part two, seeking God. Verse 5, those who look to him are radiant, their faces are never covered with shame. The poor man called and the Lord heard him. He saved him out of his troubles. It's not just me, David, it's everyone who humbles themselves. God will give this access. Verse 7, the angel of the Lord encamps around those who fear him and delivers them. Okay, let's stop here for a second. You ever wondered where the doctrine of guardian angels came from? That verse, right there. Okay, so this is kind of a side sermon, little mini sermon. Let's talk guardian angels. First of all, when you're in the genre of the Psalms or any of the poetry in the Bible, do not make whole doctrines out of any phrase or one verse. That's generally a really great rule for every verse in the Bible, but it's especially true for the genre of poetry, because the poetry genre is meant to inspire and lift and teach us kind of big picture things, and there's a lot of metaphor in there as it does that. So if we're going to actually pull verses out of Psalms and make doctrines out of them, one of the doctrines we have to make is that it's sometimes God is a female chicken. Because the psalmist says that he takes us under his wings like a mother hen. So it's just not the right way to look at this type of genre. And plus, you don't need a guardian angel. Is there angels? Yes. Does God send angels to spiritually fight for us? And I don't understand it all, but yes, there seems to be passages where it talks about this. But you don't need some angel assigned you at birth named Ned. There's no Ned hanging over your shoulder and helping you sleep at night and making sure you cross the road. That's goofiness. The reason you don't need Ned the angel, you have Jesus, the deity, the God. You have the Holy Spirit living in you. You have the Father. You have the triune God at your acts. This is what this whole psalm is about. David's going, I don't care how much Saul persecutes me. I don't care how troubled my life is. God's on my side and near me. And when I ask him, he responds. You don't need Ned the angel. You got God. Okay. Side sermon over. Let's keep going. Verse 8. Taste and see that the Lord is good. Blessed is the one who takes refuge in him. Fear the Lord, you his holy people. For those who fear him lack nothing. Fear, of course, meaning a deep awe. But it also just means be afraid. Like, it's mostly this word just used in the Bible for be afraid. And there is a part of a deep respect for God that is fearful. That is saying, God, your ways are higher than mine, and you are loving, forgiven, and grace-filled, that you are also just and holy and uncompromising in your justice. Verse 10, the lions. What is the metaphor here? It's proud people, strong people. The lions may grow weak and hungry. Even strong people run into troubles. But those who seek the Lord lack no good thing. Okay, so he starts with praise. I'm going to humble and hype up God. Humble myself and hype up God. Then he goes, let's all seek God. Because if you seek him, you can find him the way I found him. And then he goes into teaching, exhorting about living for God. Part 3, living for God. Verse 11, come my children, listen to me. I will teach you to fear the Lord. Whoever of you loves life and desires to see many good days, keep your tongue from evil and your lips from telling lies. In the Hebrew, this actually says, stop making stupid Twitter comments. In the Hebrew, it kind of says, Facebook is useless to change people's opinion. We're at a place right now, and by the way, can I just say something, y'all? I apologize for America. We are having a dialogue down here that I just pray for us. We need to have a revelation of civility and calmness and diplomacy and tact and intelligence and sometimes just not saying anything in our words. All right, I'm going to keep going because it's too discouraging. Watch your tongue. Verse 14, turn from evil and do good, seek peace and pursue it. The eyes of the Lord are on the righteous and his ears are attentive to their cry. But the face of the Lord is against those who do evil, to blot out their name from the earth. The righteous cry out and the Lord hears them. He delivers them from all their troubles. The Lord is close to the brokenhearted and save those who are crushed in spirit. The righteous person may have many troubles, but the Lord delivers him from them all. He protects all his bones. Not one of them is broken. Evil will slay the wicked. The foes of the righteous will be condemned. The Lord will rescue his servants. No one who takes refuge in him will be condemned. What is David saying here? There's a lot of ideas in here. This is why it's a great hit. It has a lot of appeal. But there's three big themes, three big applications. David gets in a cave and he says, I'm going to change the narrative from David versus Saul, that hit song, to what David is declaring about God and our response to this God. What are David's fugitive declarations? Three, they're simple, but they're profound, and they have wide-ranging application in our life today. Here's the first one. I will praise God passionately and publicly. David is saying, worship is not a private, little, quiet thing that I do. That our God, once you know him and how responsive he is and how good he is and how he rescues and listens to the lowly, should be praised publicly, earnestly, passionately, enthusiastically, and persistently. Now, here's the thing. Can I make a confession to you? I've become kind of a weather wimp. I grew up in eastern Washington State. It was cold. It was freezing. It was below zero. I mean, it was ice 9 months out of the year. You got to put the snow tires on. You got to plug your car in. And I used to actually be able to go out in that weather and be fine. It didn't bother me at all. Then I moved to California, Northern California especially. It is so beautiful down here, people. It is perfect weather all the time. Every once in a while, we'll get a little mist of a rain, and Californians shut down everything, run into their houses. There's car accidents, cats and dogs living together. I mean, it's the second there's any weather here, people start freaking out. We have people wearing parkas in September here. Now listen, I've become a weather wimp. The second we get a little weather here in Northern California, I got 3 sweatshirts on and I got the heat cranked up in my house and built a fire. Here's what I think has happened in the middle of all of COVID. Some of us, many of us, have become worship wimps. We're so used to worship being provided for us. The band puts all the music together. The production team puts all the worship together. Everything is going. We've got lyrics on the screen. And the lyrics are simplified. And there's auto-tune. And, you know, we have become worship wimps. We're like, I can't worship because they canceled church and now I'm on my couch and my kids are there with me. We've got to actually get tougher. I'm sorry that we're not having church as normal. But God is still worthy to be worshipped. Is just a little digital disruption all it takes to get the church to stop worshiping? My friend, I want you to start meditating on who God is, what he's done, how available he is, and I want you to lean into worship. I will extol the Lord at all times. I will extol the Lord at all times. Now is the time. But we need to humble ourselves and lift God up. Glorify the Lord with me. Now is the time. We need to do it and do it as one church. Who am I lifting up? Who are you worshiping? You know, oftentimes, what we're really worshiping is comfort and convenience. They're our idols. And sometimes we're worshiping multiple gods. Comfort, convenience, success, identity, and ourself. I want this to be good for me. Maybe God is actually doing something profoundly uncomfortable so that people will seek him. Maybe, I've been to a lot of prayer meetings. You've been to a lot of prayer meetings? At these prayer meetings, Christians pray things like this. God, bring revival. Send revival. And by that we mean, let our church numbers really, really grow so we look good in Christian publications like Outreach Magazine. Maybe when we pray, God, bring revival, what he hears is, let the culture get so disrupted that people consider the gospel. Maybe you and I praying for revival is partly what's going on here. Maybe now is the time to lean in and lift God up and worship him alone. Okay, number one theme of David, I will praise God passionately and publicly. Number two, I will trust God to protect me. I'll let God be my defender. I'm not going to worry about Saul. I'm not going to worry about the Philistines. I'm going to let God be my protector. I was on a board once, and the head of my board, this was for all of our missionaries that I was over when I was working with college students, and I was a missionary to secular university campuses. The head of the board, a great mentor of mine, very wise man, very much senior in the ministry from me, and he and I got along really, really well until we got to this one financial issue about how to raise funds for the missionaries. And he just kind of went through this phase where he was like, we're not going to do it that way. And it got really oppositional between he and I. I did a bunch of research. I showed him other organizations were doing it this way. I showed him, you know, like from the scripture why I think this should work. And the more I provided evidence and an argument for this new method that we were going to use, the more he backed into a corner and said, no, Kurt, we're going to just do it by faith, and we're not going to do that appeal, and we're not going to do that ask. And man, we came to loggerheads, and it started to become a real financial crisis. Started to really impact families and how they could do their job and how they could pay their bills. And we were coming up to this very, very important board meeting, and I was getting more and more frustrated with this guy. I'm like, he doesn't respect us. I don't know what's happened to him. He isn't defending us. He isn't looking out for us. That's his job on the board. He should be the one advocating for us. And then in the middle of all this conflict, my wife asked me this question. Have you prayed about this? Have you asked God to defend you and the missionaries? Have you asked God to change his heart instead of you being the one who's trying to change his heart all the time? I said, of course I have. And then I went into my bedroom and repented and prayed. I literally got on my knees before that board meeting and said, God, I can't do it. In fact, I've made it so much worse. God, would you forgive me? Would you change my heart? And Lord, if it's at all possible, would you change the heart of my friend? Went to that board meeting the next day. Before we even started, before I handed out one thing, this guy said, hey, I want everyone to stop and I want to say something to all of you in front of Kurt. The last few months, I don't know why, but I've gotten real hard-hearted to a few new ideas. And last night in prayer, God spoke to me and he told me to listen and to change my heart. And I want to publicly apologize to Kurt. Well, of course, then I apologized to him, and we walked out of that board meeting with a better and stronger idea than either of us had. Are you saying, Kurt, that if I humble myself and I pray that God will change someone else's heart, that it'll work out? That's exactly what I am saying every time. Now, I'm not saying it'll work out exactly the way that it did there. People have free will. People have variables. But I'm saying that if you trust God to be your defender, he'll always defend you better than you can defend yourself. It may not happen in the way I just described it, but I guarantee you, no one is going to get to Judgment Day and say, God, you should have let me defend myself a little bit more. I would have been doing a better job than you. This is the massive revelation of David. When my enemies pursue me, God pursues them. David stopped defending himself, and he let God defend him. The Lord is close to the brokenhearted. Who's he talking about here? He's talking about himself. Do you know how much he had to give up? Do you know how disruptive this was to him? And saves those who are crushed in spirit. He's saying that God opposes the proud but gives grace to the humble. That he himself had learned that when he promoted himself, it went bad. And that when he humbled himself, it went good. He protects all his bones. Not one of them will be broken. So he's saying God protects the spirit. That's your emotional health. That's your spiritual health. That's your internal you. And God protects the bones. That's your physical you. That's your tangible needs. God's a better defender of both your heart and your life than you are. Listen to me. Who is defending you? Are you still defending you? It is so exhausting to defend yourself, and you're not good at it. You know what Jesus said? John 14, Jesus gets to the end of his ministry. It's all chaos. It's all conflict. And he looks at the disciples, and he says, don't defend yourself. I'm going to send you the Holy Spirit. The counselor is the word he uses. Now, this word counselor in the Greek is not like the psychological counselor. He's not saying, you know, how have you felt about your mother? And, you know, it's not that Freudian thing. You know what the counselor means there? It's defense lawyer. It's like a lawyer counselor. He's saying, I'm going to send the Holy Spirit so you can be about the job of advancing the kingdom, and the Holy Spirit will be about the job of bringing my words to your memory, comforting you in your soul, and defending you in this complicated, broken, corrupt world. The Holy Spirit will always do a better job defending you than you will. Don't send that email. Don't get into that argument. Don't stand up for your rights in that caustic way that creates conflict. Let the Holy Spirit do it for you. Who are you fighting with? Stop. Pray. And see that God is close to the brokenhearted. And he protects all your bones. Who will defend me? The Holy Spirit will defend me. That's the question we're asking here. The Holy Spirit will defend me. God will defend me. Okay, number three. First of all, I'll praise publicly and passionately. Number two, I trust God to protect me. Number three theme in this hit of hits, I will pursue both peace and I will reject evil. Now, that seems kind of obvious, but doing those two together is pretty difficult. I'm going to pursue peace, but be about justice, and I'm not going to let evil compromise anything. I'm going to go away from drama, but I'm going to stir up problems when I see people talking evil. He holds these two incredible values in tension because he knows something about the nature of mankind. He knows what Paul taught in Romans, that we actually pursue drama and support evil in our nature. We are drama people, and we love evil. We're attracted to it. We think evil is awesome. We think everyone else should stop doing evil, but we really find it fascinating, and we like it. We like to gossip. We like to slander. We like titillating things. And so in our nature, now you say, Kurt, I don't believe that in our nature stuff. Listen to me. We say stupid things like, you know, no child is born hating. People that say this have never been around a two-year-old. We come out of the womb selfish. Even prominent atheists will tell you we've got the selfishness gene. Listen, we do teach racism, and it gets worse. We do teach that sort of tribalism. We do teach all sorts of bias and hatred and stuff, and it gets worse and worse. But we come out of the womb receptive to that. We come out of the womb entirely. You're not believing me. I'm gonna have to teach this to you. So around here at Bayside, we do this thing called Breakaway. Thousands of kids, thousands and thousands of kids. Two summers ago, I volunteered to do the Bible teaching for the littlest littles, like the kindergarten, first grade, second grade kids. So I'm in this room, Every morning I'm teaching them, it's packed out. I mean, they're crawling on each other. It's just packed out with these little kids. And when we're teaching one day on the concept of forgiveness, we're going over the Bible scriptures, we're telling them why forgiveness is important, why Jesus forgives you, why you should forgive your mom and dad, your brother and sister, and we're going over it, we're making them recite verses, and we've got small group leaders helping them all listen, we got great visuals, we got a little skit. I mean, we're teaching forgiveness, 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 forgiveness. And at one point, this gal that's working with me, Carla, she's one on our team, she does something purposefully wrong, so that we can ask the kids, should we forgive Carla? So I look at all these boys and girls and say, boys and girls, should we forgive Carla? Nothing. Nothing. Not a single kid says something. Finally, this one little boy in the middle of the room stands up and says, kick her out! Kick her out! And all these kids start to chant. It's like some angry mob. I'm glad we didn't have torches. They would have burned down the church. 1,000 kids, kick her out. I'd have quieted them down. Listen, that's who we are in our nature. We're kick her out. Well, forgive me, but don't forgive them. We have a difficult time speaking well of people. This is what makes Jesus so radical. Love your enemies. Who's the person that's annoying you the most right now? Love your enemies. Paul says it this way. He says to the 1 Thessalonians, he says, love more and more and more and love everyone. In that context, in Thessalonica, the everyone was the people that stole money from them, threatened their lives, and actually the mob was so angry and violent, Paul had to sneak out in the middle of the night. And Paul writes back to them, hey, make sure you love those people. Those people that try to kill us. Love them. And that's how Christianity grows. That's how Christianity becomes powerful. That against our nature, we're pursuing peace and rejecting injustice, rejecting evil. Turn from evil and do good. Seek peace and pursue it. The face of the Lord is against those who do evil, to blot out their names from the earth. It's so true. Here's my question, my final question. Who are you fighting? Who are you fighting for? Most of us are fighting for ourselves. Some of us are fighting for our families. But most of us are fighting for our identity, our rights, our significance, our job, our economic situation, our reputation. Most of us spend most of our life fighting for ourselves. And therefore, we give ourselves license in the area of peace and evil. Is that what Jesus did? How did Jesus pursue peace and reject evil? How did he hold those two in tension? Simple. He pursued peace by pursuing us. He pursued peace by coming to earth as a man, walking among us, teaching us, washing our feet, and letting himself be crucified on a cross in our place. We're fighting for ourselves so often. Jesus came and fought for you and me. How was it that Jesus pursued peace? He came to end the enmity between us and our Father. The sin that separates us from our Creator, he said, I will come and take the place of that sin. I will pay the injustices, and I am going to solve the problem of evil by dying on the cross in your place. Jesus Christ is the ultimate pursuer of peace, not in just a way that says, I want everyone to behave, I want everyone to get along, I want everyone to have less drama, but literally coming and saying, I will heal them from the inside out and give them access to their Creator by suffering on the cross for them. That's why I praise him passionately and publicly. That's why I seek him. And that's why I want to make my life a life where drama is lowered. Peace is pursued. It's interesting to me here who David does not mention. In this song, there's no mention of Saul. There's no mention of his brothers that minimized him, his dad that ignored him. There's no mention of all of the opposition politically that he went through, of all of the violence that was threatened on his life. No, what David wants to do is not focus on all of the problems and troubles that have come into his life, but the beauty and the glory that God is a God who wants access to David. And that same God wants access to you. That same God wants to come into your life, and bring peace, and heal you from evil. But he won't force you. He's not a dictator. He invites you. He invites you to surrender your life, to give your life back to him. The life he gave you in the first place. He invites you to hear the music of his love, acceptance, and forgiveness. Can I pray for you? Father God, I thank you for this incredible song of praise and seeking you and a call to live a life like you live, Jesus. I pray that each one that hears it will walk out of here and press into worship passionately and publicly. That each one that hears this message would walk out of here and surrender the defense of themselves and let you defend them. And finally, God, make each and every one of us an agent of peace that rejects evil. I ask it in Jesus' name. Amen.
We want to prepare our hearts for communion, and so I thought I would do our last song now, and then Pastor Rick will come and lead us through communion, and then he can pray the benediction over us. So thank you, Jesus, for speaking to us through videos on the internet. Let's worship God together. The song I'm going to sing is Man of Sorrows. Of heaven.
salvation by your love poured out over me. Now my soul cries out, hallelujah, praise and honor unto thee. Now my debt is paid, it is paid in full by the precious blood that my Jesus spilled. Now the curse of sin has no hold on me, whom the Son sets free. Oh, it's free indeed. Now my debt is paid, it is paid in full by the precious blood that my Jesus spilled. Now the curse of sin has no hold on me, whom the Son sets free. Oh, is free indeed. Oh, that rugged cross, my salvation, where your love poured out over me. Now my soul cries out, condemnation in our place through his death.
Apostle Paul shared with the Corinthian church, "For I have received from the Lord that which also I delivered unto you, that in the night in which he was betrayed, Jesus took bread, and when he had given thanks, he broke it and gave it to his disciples." Let us pray. Gracious God, our Father in heaven, we thank you for the sending of your Son, the Lord Jesus Christ, into this world to redeem us, to purchase us back to the Father, to pay the price for our sin, that we might no longer stand condemned before you. Thank you for this bread that represents the body of our Lord Jesus Christ. In his name I pray. Amen. After he gave thanks, he broke the bread and gave it to his disciples. Let's partake of that together. Paul goes on to say, in the same manner he took the cup after supper, saying, "This cup is the new covenant in my blood, which is shed for you. This do as often as we drink it in remembrance of him." As often as we eat this bread and drink this cup together, we proclaim the Lord's death until he comes again. Let us join again in prayer. Gracious God, our Father, thank you for the love that you have demonstrated to all of humankind, to us, your children, demonstrated to us through the giving of your Son, as a testimony of your love for us. You sent Jesus to this earth. And we thank you that by faith we can look to him who was lifted up on that cross, who paid the price for our sin, but did not die in vain. And we thank you, Father, that you raised him up from the grave. May we continue to live out that faith in our lives. May we rejoice together and exalt the Lord as we go forth from this place today. Thank you for the privilege of having gathered together, the few of us here and those who have been watching. And may we continue to worship and glorify you through the lives that we live. Now the Lord bless you and keep you. The Lord make his face to shine upon you and be gracious to you. The Lord lift up his countenance towards you and give you his peace. In Jesus' name I pray. Amen. Amen. Thank you for being here today. It's great to be with you again. God bless you.